Hear now the reading of the Word of God. First of all, in Micah, the 6th chapter, the 6th and 8th verses. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before the high God? He has shown you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God? And the Apostle Paul, writing to the Colossians, said in the 17th verse of the 3rd chapter, and whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. And Jesus said, pray this way. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Let us pray. It is with awe and wonder that we come into your presence, gracious Lord. We come by your invitation. The very desire to pray has been placed in our hearts by you. You desire to talk to us even more than we long to talk with you. We thank you that prayer begins in your heart, sweeps into our hearts, and creates in us the desire to know you and love you and serve you. All praise be to you, Lord, that you have called us into intimate communication with you and given us the gift of prayer, so that we could spread out before you all of our needs and experience not only your gifts, but yourself. Lord, our deepest longing is to know you and love you and serve you all of the days of our lives. In your holy name, amen. Some time ago, I asked a friend how his day had gone. He said, extraordinary. Well, I thought that was a marvelous response to a day. But I thought that that was probably a special day. And so I tested him out. I asked the same question every time I saw him in the evening. How's your day? Extraordinary, he said. Well, finally, I began to evaluate my day. How many days could I say extraordinary? I ask you the same question. How many of your days are extraordinary? So one day I said to my friend, why is it that you always respond describing your day as extraordinary? He said, listen, just enjoying the ordinary moments of every day is an extraordinary experience. Today I want to talk to you about living an extraordinary life by discovering the holiness of God, his presence and his power in every moment. You know, if we wait for an extraordinary moment, we'll wait a long time. As a matter of fact, life is made up of 99% of ordinary experiences. And as for people, I think we're all ordinary. You know, we have to eat and sleep, and we have to prepare and think and pray. But the thing that makes us extraordinary is what God does in us and through us. But our problem is that we divide life into parts. We constantly long for some spectacular experience and miss the miracle of the ordinary. You know, if you ever had the experience of talking with someone and been so intent on what you were going to say in response to what he or she said that when he or she was finished, you forgot what he or she had said? Or have you ever been in a situation and so concerned about the next thing you had to do that you couldn't put your mind on that situation? Or have you ever been so concerned about tomorrow that you really didn't live today? The ordinary. Life is made up of ordinary moments and ordinary people. And there's a secret of making the ordinary extraordinary. I talked to a man the other day. He was so pleased to tell me that his son was going to become a clergyman. Well, he said, my son is going into full-time Christian service. I said, my friend, what have you been in all these years? Full-time? Well, he said, he's going to become a clergyman. He's going to give his whole life to the Lord. Oh, really? I said, have you ever done that? He said, oh, well, you don't understand. You know, he's going to be a church worker and give everything and all of his time. You know, 24 hours a day to the Lord. And I said, my friend, to be in Christ and to trust Christ with your life is to be in the ministry. You're in full-time Christian service, whether you like it or not. But how often we divide the sacred and the secular. We think of our churches as sacred places, but neglect our communities, saying, oh, that's just secular. You know that the word secular means secularis, the now. Don't you imagine that perhaps God, who is sacred and holy, has a plan for every now? Extraordinary in the ordinary. Can't divide life into parts. I hold my Bible in my hand, and that's sacred. It's holy in the sense that it's God's word. And yet, as I read, I meet him, and that has something to say about everything else I read, and every movie I go to, and everything I watch on television. I enjoy coming here to the sanctuary, not only when all of us are here and worship, but also in quiet moments. But in a sense, isn't Hollywood Boulevard a sanctuary? Doesn't it belong to the Lord as much as this sanctuary? A great man in the 18th century by the name of Jean-Paul de Caussade used to lecture to the nuns about the sacrament of the present moment. Recently, his works have been translated by Kitty Muggeridge, the wife of Malcolm Muggeridge, the great British journalist. This little book contains the secret of discovering the miracle of the ordinary. The present moment, right now, is all we have. And when we surrender it to the Lord, life becomes extraordinary. Richard Foster, who has become distinguished for his outstanding works on Christian prayer and discipline, said that he read that little book as he flew across the nation, and it transformed his life because he discovered that the Lord is as present in worship as he is in work, in the times of need as well as the times of hope, the times of the mundane as well as the magnificent. All of life is holy. That's what Jesus wanted to teach his disciples in what has been called improperly the Lord's Prayer. It's really the disciples' prayer. 66 words. It only takes a portion of a minute to repeat. But if you believe it, it'll transform your life and bring revolution wherever you are. Jesus' disciples' prayer is a mandate. It's a manifesto. It's a way to experience the power of God, a guide to our prayers, but also a blueprint. And it all begins in the one dynamic petition, the first of seven, that makes all of the others possible. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Or in more contemporary language, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. What does that mean to you when you pray that? Could it be possible that constant repetition through the years has led to a kind of faithless familiarity? Could it be that you say those words without recognizing what you're saying? And if so, perhaps we need to take a few moments today, as we begin the series on the disciples' prayer, to wonder what does it mean to say Our Father, or to ask Him for the hallowing of His name. Let's consider that together. The extraordinary dimension of life is that we can say Our Father. The eternal Creator and Sustainer, Redeemer of all, El Shaddai, Yahweh, Adonai, the Lord, Jehovah Shema, who is everywhere, Jehovah Shalom, who is our peace, is our Father. Think of it. God has created you and me and given us the rebirth right of knowing that we are His children. And that's the extraordinary dimension to bring to the ordinary pressures and concerns of life. Remember in the 9th chapter of Jeremiah, when the Lord speaks through Jeremiah, saying, "Let not the mighty man glory in his might. Let not the wise man glory in his wisdom. Let not the rich man glory in his riches. But let him who glories glory in this, that he understands and knows me, that I am justice and loving kindness and mercy in the earth. All such I take delight in." The Lord delights in us, and He's created us to be His children. Begin there, for that's the amazing, wondrous truth that begins everything else. We cannot pray without that liberating truth and conviction. The Apostle Paul was literally overcome by it. He realized that instead of the spirit of bondage, the Lord had given him a spirit of adoption, whereby he could cry, "Abba, Father," the same word that Jesus had used, "Daddy," the most intimate word of loving companionship, not only with a Creator, but with a loving Lord. To say Our Father is our privilege. When Paul wrote to the Galatians in the 4th chapter, in that 6th verse, "But because you are sons, God sent the Spirit of His Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father." It is by God's grace that we call Him Father. He calls us, elects us, appoints us, predestines us, and calls us into a family relationship. And in His Son, He shares His family likeness. And when His Son comes to live in us, we're made like Him, and we are able to pray, Abba, Father. But what does it mean to say, "Hallowed be your name"? How can we hallow God's name? The very term hallowed means holy, to make holy. How can we add one bit of holiness to God? It almost seems presumptuous, doesn't it? And that's why it's in the passive mood, hallowed be. But it's also in the imperative, and it's in the definiteness of the aorist mood. It really means, Lord, do what we can't do. Make us want what you want. For He wants more than anything else for us to see every moment, every hour, every day, every person, every situation, every challenge, every problem, every crisis in the context of His holiness. When we say, "Hallowed be your name," we're really saying, "Lord, manifest yourself." That's what Jesus prayed in His high priestly prayer. "Father, I have manifested your name. Father, keep them in your name." It's really the revelation of the Lord, the hallowing of life. And it really means that we ask for and seek the name. Among the ancient Hebrews, God was so sacred they never said his name. They simply said the name. And so it became a part of the fiber of the conversation of Jesus with his disciples. The name was God himself, the hallowing of God in everyday life is the gift that Jesus Christ gives us. Now, we who cannot hallow him can surrender everything that his holiness might be made manifest. And that's what Peter means when in the 15th verse of the third chapter of his first letter, he said, sanctify your hearts. And so in a sense, the hallowing of all of life requires our cooperation. God created it that way. He gave us freedom. And so to live an extraordinary life in the ordinary moments means that we say, Lord, manifest your holiness, your presence, your power, your name. The name really means the authority, the power, the person, the nature, the personality, the character of the one who's named. And so we ask for the fullness of the Spirit of God, for his wisdom in the midst of our misunderstanding, his power in the midst of our weaknesses, his strength in the midst of our inadequacy, his vision in the midst of our hopelessness. And he comes and he blesses life. You see what that means? It means that we wake up in the morning and thank him for the day. It means that when we eat, we thank him for the gift of food. It means that when we express love and care, we thank him for a person and seek never to misuse that person. As a woman said to her husband, today when you leave, just give me an ordinary kiss. And he said, an ordinary kiss? There are no ordinary kisses. Well, there are no ordinary people in this sense. They're all special, wonderful gifts from God, manifestations of his grace. And so in making a living and in making love, in making peace in broken relationships, wherever we are, we're on holy ground. Elizabeth Barrett Browning said, all earth is crammed with heaven and every bush aflame with God. Do you see that? Wonderful experience of asking for the hallowing of God's name is, first of all, examination. We examine all of life and ask, how can we pray for the hallowing of life unless we're willing to be co-cooperators with God in seeking and doing his will? But it also means exoneration for the failures, for the times that we neglect his presence and power, and think of people and situations as common. But then, having been freed by forgiveness, we are given the gift of living expectantly, looking forward for the unfolding of each moment, knowing that when we come to the end of the day, we will have lived an extraordinary day, because in it, we will have met him, seen life and people and problems as his gift for the revelation and freeing of his power in us and through us. Lord, hallowed be your name.